This is our Pastor's Corner teaching series. We're looking in the Old Testament, specifically at the books of the minor prophets. Today, we're in the second half of the book of Joel. So if you need to catch up, go ahead and look back at our previous video on Joel chapter 1 and the first half of chapter 2. Today, if you're tuning in, we're going to be focusing in on Joel chapter 2, verse 18 to the end of the book. So I want to encourage you here to maybe stop this video and open your Bible, turn it on, and read Joel chapter 2, verse 18 all the way to the end. So if you're doing that with us, we want to take you through a bit of a quick summary from the previous section and then lead us into where we're heading today. So in the previous section, we had chapters 1 and 2. You had this dynamic of a locust swarm that has happened and has devastated the land. And in this, Joel is looking and seeing that this is a judgment from God. And in fact, he's paralleling this now and saying, I see a future judgment in which God will do something similar, not with a locust that will destroy the land, but with an army that's going to invade. And so he's calling the people to repent. He's calling them to turn from their ways. And the idea of repentance, again, was you're heading in one direction, you stop, you turn around, and you go the opposite direction. And that opposite direction is, in fact, God's direction. And so here we find ourselves now in Joel chapter 2, verse 18. And it starts with this idea now. God is going to respond to Joel and his message and to the people of Israel as they have decided to repent. So in verse 18, we have this image now that God is jealous for his land and took pity on his people. And in fact, the impending calamity that Joel is seeing is now going to be averted because God is seeing the genuine repentance of his people. So he's now going to take this image and he's going to make this a future image farther down the road. So when Joel was saying, hey, something's going to happen really soon if we don't change our ways, God is now relenting on that and saying, okay, I'm going to show you even farther now what this will look like. So in verse 18, you have how God is going to respond to his people, and he's going to relent on his judgment. He's going to relent on this invasion. But in verses 20 to 21, what we're going to find now is God is going to use the day of the Lord, and he's going to reverse all the things that have happened. So the people have experienced this locust swarm, how it has devastated everything. Now God is going to say, that same image, I'm going to reverse it all for you down in the future. So here's what it looks like. In verses 20 to 21, God's saying, you know, this impending army, I will be the one to defeat this impending army. I will defeat these invaders. And then verses 22 to 26, he continues on to say, now, you know, because the locusts had come in and destroyed your land, I'm going to fight for you. I'm going to take on this army for you. And in fact, what will happen now in verses 22 to 26 is that the land that you have will be restored and you will live in a land full of abundance. So rather than having the swarm devastate everything, God is going to allow the land to reproduce everything and grow with great abundance. And then in verse 27, this is one of the key verses. I'm going to read this to you. It says, then you will know that I am in Israel, that I am the Lord your God, and that there is no other. Never again will my people be shamed. You see, I love that. That's the idea of God doing all this, is so that you will know I am your God, you are my people. That same image and that same wording applies to those of us who call ourselves Jesus people today. I will be your God, you will be my people. That same calling is there for us. And the amazing thing is that God will be with them. God will be with them. God's presence will be amongst them and amongst the people all the time from this day forth. So that's the image now looking farther down at this day of the Lord. So now, rather than this image of impending doom and judgment and gloom, God is reversing this image of the day of the Lord to be something great, victorious, and amazing. So rather than have an army destroy everything, God's going to fight on behalf of his people, restore the land to its great abundance, and in fact, he will stay and reside with his people. One thing to key in on here as we continue on is in verse 28. It says this, and afterward, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy, your old men will dream dreams, and your young men will see visions. And if you can, just read the rest of chapter 2 all the way to verse 32 there. And this portion here is this great encouragement that God will be with his people. He will fill all his people with his own presence. See, for Israel, they had only known this idea of God being in the temple, being in this physical building structure. And God is in this portion promising that he will be with his people and he will fill them up. Now, This is only in light of the fact that we have the New Testament. If you read Acts chapter 2, verse 16, you will see that this is the same moment in which the Holy Spirit comes upon the people of God. The Holy Spirit comes on Jesus' disciples, and then, boom, there's an explosion of this witness, this great witness of Jesus that becomes the church. And in that portion, we have an understanding that this is the Holy Spirit of God coming and residing in his people. See, no longer is it going to be in a building. It's going to be in the very fact that God will live in his people through the Holy Spirit. It's a simple reminder for us again. Church is not a building, right? You and I, we are the church. We are the living embodiment of Jesus Christ. His Spirit lives within us. So when you have confessed Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, the Holy Spirit takes up residence in your heart and in your life, and he then directs and guides now how you will live and where you will go and what you will do, and keeps you in line with the will and the purposes of God the Father. So here we have this already, and this great fulfillment of this same image happens in Acts. And in fact, if you read that, Peter, the disciple, quotes this section here as evidence that, hey, this prophecy is now fulfilled. Now in chapter 3, you're continuing to move forward in this understanding of the day of the Lord. So not only will God's presence reside among his people, God will do something with all the nations of the world. And so here we have, God will confront all the evil among all the nations, and he will turn violence on himself. And in actuality, what he's saying is, I will make the wrong things right. All the things that have ever gone wrong, all the things that have, the people who have wronged you as a nation, the other countries that have been trying to destroy you, Israel, I will make this right. And this is the idea then of this future time when God will take evil, take this evil in the world, and he will vanquish it. It will be completely gone. See, for you and I, when God created the world, everything was great. And then in Genesis 3, because you and I want to go our own way, and Adam and Eve wanted to do things their own way, everything was ruined. And since that time, nothing is the way it should be. This isn't the way God intended our world to be. And so throughout this entire story of your Bible, God is at work making sure that he will restore the world, you and me, human relationships, the relationship between God and us. All this restoration will come where the wrong things will be made right, and God will vanquish evil forever. And so this is a great image looking forward. We're in this period now where the kingdom of God has already come in this present form, but it's not yet fully complete. And we still wait for this day of the Lord, as Joel has been talking about, where God will make all these wrong things right. It's an amazing image to keep our eyes focused on the very fact that something greater will happen down the road. So in the midst of this circumstance right now, for example, like coronavirus right now, our eyes are not to be just stuck solely on what's happening today, but God will make this right. There will be no more pain. There will be no more suffering. There will be no more viruses in the future when God fully restores his kingdom. And so God will confront all evil that we've been enduring, all evil that continues to go on in this world, and he will vanquish it forever. And you know what's amazing about this is that you and I are supposed to participate in this. In fact, when you look at the Beatitudes of Jesus, he says, if you want to be part of my citizenship of the kingdom, these are the attributes that you're going to take. And it's subversive to all the evils that go on in the world. And so if you have time, I want to encourage you to look at Matthew chapter 5 and see how God is inviting us to participate with these characteristics, to say, if you carry out these characteristics, you are in the process of making sure wrong things are made right. And there will come a day when all of that will be dealt with. And so we look forward to that day as well. In verses 17 to 21 of chapter 3, you have more imagery now here. And it gives us this image of the full restoration of all of creation. Again, God is in the process of making wrongs right. But again, since Genesis, when everything has been broken, God is now in the process of restoring everything to the way he originally had created it. So God's justice and God's restoration, this idea of the new Eden, will come into this picture. And that's a great, again, forward picture for us to look forward to. So with this book of Joel, that's pretty much the whole concept of this book. What are some of the things that you and I are supposed to take away from this book? I think one of the things that we're supposed to take away when we continue to see Joel in light of God's purposes is that God is still in the business of drawing people to himself. See, after all, Israel was called to be a specific group of people for God, to represent God, to show the world what God's chosen people would be like, what God's people would be like. And ultimately, they would fail. But eventually, there will come one person from Israel who would demonstrate what it really meant to be truly human, and that was Jesus Christ. And then for you and me, we get to participate in this same privilege of being truly human the way God intended us to be when we receive Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, and when we decide to follow him and follow the ways he lived. And he directs us back into a good relationship with God. And so God continues to draw people to himself. He started it so many years ago with this group of people called the Israelites. They were supposed to be an exclusive nation, not because they were great or better, but simply because they were just chosen by God. And they were supposed to be an example to all the nations around them. That's the same call you and I have as Jesus people. We are called apart, not because of we're special or great, but because God called us and chose us. He loves us. And we're supposed to continue to point people in the direction of Jesus. And we're supposed to continue to draw people to see how we live in such a way that it's evidence that Jesus lives with us. And somehow the way we live will point people back to Jesus. So God is still in this business of drawing people to himself. And he invites you and me to participate in this great endeavor. The second thing that I really took encouragement from in this book is if we ever wander in our faith, God fights to bring us back. I really like that image, is that God fights to bring us back. You see, the image that Joel was seeing was that there was this army that was going to invade, and unless Israel was willing to repent and turn from their wicked ways and turn back to God, this was going to happen. But it wasn't the purpose to destroy Israel. The purpose was that they would turn back to God, and God was trying to wake up and get their attention. God was saying, you're going the wrong way. You're not doing the things the way I hope you want, that lead to life. And so I'm going to fight for you to get your attention. You know, and I've continued to discover in my own life that God continues to fight for my attention. A lot of things are taking away our attention today. Everything from our smartphones to what we can do with our time on Netflix and on all the other various activities that run on in our lives. And God continues to fight to get our attention. Far be it for us to be so deaf to God that he would have to bring some kind of really devastating, almost difficult calamity upon us. And we don't want that. We don't think that as a great thing. But God is saying, I'm going to do anything I need to do to get your attention, to turn you back to me. And so sometimes we need to start paying attention to those little blips that happen in our life. What is God saying in this? What is God doing in this? Is there something that I need to recognize that's not, I'm not going God's way and God's trying to get my attention? This, people think maybe this whole COVID thing is one of the ways in which God is saying, hey, wake up. Turn back to me. I'm doing something. I want you to get on board with what I'm doing, but you're not following the way I want you to. So maybe that's something for us to consider. Another thing, of course, one of the big themes of this book was repentance, the idea of, again, turning from our ways and turning back to God's way. And what I like about this prophecy of Joel is that it's not just this physical act of just turning. It's more than just that. It was this heart attitude that we need to have. Again, one of the greatest difficulties we have as Christians is our pride and our arrogance. The fact that we think that we're so great or so spiritually mature all the time. And that hinders our ability to repent. That hinders us from really stopping from going our way and turning to going God's way. So repentance is a huge theme in this book. I hope it's something that we take to heart always when we live our lives as Christians. Don't always sit there thinking, I've got it all figured out. I've read the Bible so many times. I know what it says inside and out. No, we always need to have a humble attitude and be repentant. After all, the more we value what Christ has done for us, the greater our witness will be. The more we value what Christ has done for us, the greater our witness will be. And the last thing is this, is that God's Spirit is poured out on us. You and I, we have this great gift of the Holy Spirit. He continues to live in us. So for those of us who have called Jesus Christ our Lord and Savior, the Spirit has taken up residence in our life. Now, here's the thing. We need to listen better to him. We need to really just tune in better to where he would lead us and guide us. Far too often, we study the Bible like this, and we have a lot of good head knowledge about it. But the Spirit of God is working in us fine-tuning us, saying, hey, there's something I want you to do about this. There's something I want you to change in your life. There's something that I want to do with you. And you know, that this is one of the key aspects of our faith, is that God is continually working in us and shaping us. Now, here's the challenge that goes with it, is that he also calls us to do uncomfortable things. He also calls us to do uncomfortable things that we're not familiar with, that we're not comfortable with. And that's part of this journey that we find ourselves on. So God's Spirit is with us. And you know what that reminds me of as well? Is the very fact that you and I, because God is with us, what do we have to fear? Because God is with us, what do we have to fear? And I think that's an amazing encouragement all the time. So, brothers and sisters, this is the book of Joel in a nutshell. This is part two, and we're done part two here, and I hope that has encouraged you, and I hope that's challenged you. Go ahead and finish reading up this book as well, and just allow it to sink in and just really see how God is working. Our next stop on this journey of the minor prophets will be in the book of Jonah. Sometimes it's a very familiar book for some of you, but for others, not so much. So next week, tune in. We'll look at the book of Jonah. In the meantime, love and peace. God bless.